there are plenty of such very practical unity level examples. Others very important include the importance of religious notions around land, the sacredness of the land, ancestors, and so on. It's another nice example, but I'll leave it for time reasons. And let's move to religious practices. That's the scenario example can also be used here. Let's look at peace building rituals, cleansing rituals. Now, when you have been contaminated by war and violence, you can't just go back to the community and say, well, hello, here I am. That was, it's, you have to first be cleansed. And I remember from Liberia after the war, here we go, you had these new charismatic churches that had a lot of us coming from a mainline Christian tradition to test. I think they're not doing the right thing. But what they did do is offer these kids, or some of them, offer these kids a new perspective, a new hope. Because these kids, they top of the stage, they confessed that the horrible things that they had done during the war, and killing the people, I mean, just horrible, and still they have a whole life to go. How are they going to be accepted again in the community? In this case, by telling what they had done and how they wanted to change their life, and by being accepted by the community again, because with the help of God, they could actually be born again. And I've sometimes said that this idea of being able to be born again is one of the great opportunities, one of the great assets in these charismatic churches. Now, I think we have to look at that notion a bit more carefully and being a bit more humble, as some of you would say here. Now, think of healing rituals, of course. And it's very important also from a development perspective that most people in the world do not consider issues of health and illness in purely physical terms, but again in an integral and holistic approach to it that includes the physical and the spiritual. So your spiritual state of mind, your spiritual state of being also has to be in good health, otherwise your physical body is going to suffer. Religious organization, the third category that I mentioned. Now this, of course, I'm not going to say much about it because that's most manifest in the form of religious communities, and we heard about that this morning, there was talk of that. Service delivery is, of course, a very known aspect for developing agents, outreach to the poor, social trust. I mean, there's whole literature on that that everybody can read. And on the element of religious experience, and I think that's the most neglected element of religion, also because it's so difficult to grasp, it's intangible, it's invasive, difficult to understand, but nevertheless, it's often individuals that have undergone a profound religious or spiritual experience of a transformative nature, who have given up their old ways of life to serve the community in an exemplary manner. And it's ironic, perhaps, but nevertheless a fact, that among them are the founders of the major religious traditions as we know them today. I'm thinking of the historical person of Jesus, the Prophet Muhammad, the Buddha, they're all convincing examples of the profound nature of the religious experience that has literally been life-changing. Now, I want to say at this point a few words about the idea of prosperity, because a lot of the new religious trends in Christianity, the new churches, that are referred to as prosperity churches. Yeah? And in a condescending manner, because we always label others and in ways that we teach we don't really like them, because they're not doing things like we do. And so they're not right. It's a bit of bad religion in a way. In this case, that Christianity. But the idea that the religious dimension is crucial for material development is not foreign to Europe, where material prosperity used to be seen as a sign of virtue and divine blessing. That's not that long ago. And it's widely acknowledged that religious ideas take an important part in the development of capitalism in the history of Europe. And this was not primarily as a result of direct action by religious institutions, but through the influence of religious ideas on people's thinking. And so the importance of religious ideas that were concerned with the legitimacy of wealth, with the moral value of certain financial operations, such as lending, saving, or investing money, for example. I mean, it's interesting that we know the ban on interest in Islam, and instead, a whole range of techniques have been developed on the principle of the sharing of profit and loss. So it's not that I get the benefits and you suffer. That's sort of both you share the profit and the loss. And I think that not very many people are aware that this was also the case in the past, this ban on interest in Christianity. Of course, the same thing, it's from loss. And I think that the Reformation has something to do with that. But it just goes to illustrate the significance of religious ideas in forming people's ideas about material prosperity, which express themselves, of course, differently at various times and at various places. And in a recent study, fairly recent study, the Ghanaian theologian, and he's a theologian of one of these charismatic churches, Kingsley Larby, he has pointed out how prosperity refers to, and I quote him, to the ability to live a happy and balanced life without the problem of having to think what to eat, where to sleep, what to wear, how to meet one's social expectations like school fees, children's education, and the ability to contribute to the needs of one's community. And so what he argues is that the religious message must be placed within the social and economic realities of a particular country, and it must be understood in terms of traditional concepts of life for it to be appreciated. So there's an undeniable relation between the visible and the invisible worlds, in the sense that a person who is in a good state of spiritual health can also expect to prosper materially. And so that is the logic, and that's a bit more subtle than the idea that all these people are shouting for prosperity and giving profits and so on. A South African, more mainline Pentecostal theologian, who's written a lot on Pentecostalism, so he's not, well, the first on the street, so to speak. He has stated it as follows. And he's basically saying that the prosperity gospel promises access to power which will cater for the necessities of life and protect it from its vicissitudes. A life that is full, prosperous, healthy, peaceful, and secure. End quote. Now, these are all concerns that address basic human needs, also in the opinion of Western development agents. And it also compares with the view of the UNDP, the United Nations Development Programme, which has repeatedly stated that human development is, and then I quote, is about creating an environment in which people can develop their full potential and lead productive, creative lives in accord with their needs and interests. And so the point is that also the UNDP the concept of human development refers to people's resources beyond any material aspect. So development today is widely understood as human development. So it broadens the concept what we can do to include aspects that go beyond the economic meaning that is often exclusively ascribed to it. And this broader understanding of development allows for a different approach also by development workers and donors in such a way, and here's the word, that it empowers people to develop the full range of resources at their disposal. And my point is that this includes people's spiritual and religious resources. And it's, let me skip a last bit and just conclude that by saying, because I can see you starting to move around.
It is a little bit of a sign, isn't it?
Yes, no, it's lovely. It's lovely. I've always followed too. So the point is that as far as I can see, that is neither a good reason nor a rational argument that could justify the neglect of one important human resource if and when people actually have it. And we must ask ourselves, what can we do to mobilize people's religious or spiritual resources to realize human development in the broadest sense? And this is what I would call spiritual empowerment. It doesn't mean that you're going around telling people, but obviously you must be religious. It just means that you say, well, that this is what people have, and let's build on what they have and not on what they do not have. Yeah? It's not, in my view, it's not so much new policy instruments that we need, but what we need is a new vision of what development means and how it should be